Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. We just heard about some amazing technologies. These technologies are changing healthcare today and will continue to do so for decades to come. I'm going to change gears a bit and talk about the value that these innovations bring, the value they bring to individuals and to society. The consequences of medical innovation on population health and healthcare costs are potentially enormous. So we need to understand the value so that we can think about how health policy in our healthcare system needs to evolve along with our medical innovation. This story really begins with the longevity revolution in the 20th century. In just 50 years, female life expectancy increased by a quarter. This was truly remarkable. One of the major drivers of this is medical technology. Leslie Saxon gave us a great example of medical innovation that led to the longevity revolution in the treatment of heart disease. There were innovations in pharmaceuticals with antihypertensives and statins. There were innovations in surgical procedures and medical devices with implantable defibrillators and angioplasty. These innovations literally rescued people from death. Today, we have innovations again that are emerging that could transform health in the future. The next longevity revolution may be in the number of years we live disease-free, and it may come from existing technologies, or it may come from technologies that have not yet been invented. We are a very creative species. We love to create. We also like to use. We like to buy what we create. And that brings me to a second important trend of the 20th century, and that's the rising healthcare costs. The U.S. spends more on healthcare than any other nation, both on a per capita and an overall level. And healthcare costs are rising dramatically. They're expected to be over $4 trillion in 2015. And again, medical technology is a major driver. In fact, about half of the growth in healthcare costs are attributed to medical technology. So we need to think about the value, how much value innovation offers. And you can think about value as being derived from health, longer, better quality lives, as well as spending. So we can derive value from lowering our spending and hopefully having no negative impact on health, or we can derive value by higher spending, but with health benefits that are worth it. So at USC, we built a model that can quantify the value of innovation. Actually, we've been building this model for over a decade. And what we do with this model is we start with big data, a lot of data on Americans who have been followed over many, many decades. And we take their information and we model how they age. We look at how their health changes, how their healthcare utilization changes, how their income and wealth changes. And then with these models, we can project population health and healthcare expenditures for future populations of Americans. We can project it all the way out to future years, say to 2050. So then with this model, we can then look at health and spending outcomes with different assumptions about medical innovation, how medical innovation will change. So I'd like to talk about two examples in particular. The first one is an area in which medical innovation has potential to add a lot of social value, and that's in the delaying the aging process. A large part of our 20th century success in fighting diseases led us to focus on the burden of illness. That is, the diseases that cost the most, received the most attention, got the most R&D funding. Our system is built around reimbursement tied to the diagnosis and treatment of individual diseases. On the other hand, prevention is not sufficiently rewarded. It's very hard to get an FDA drug approved for a healthy person. And I call this the disease mindset. But in reality, as people live longer, they're more likely to have a cluster of diseases rather than one individual disease. So if we look at some data, we see that among Americans age 65 and older, 37% have four or more conditions. So it leads us to ask, is this disease mindset still really an appropriate one? So what if instead we were to shift the focus to slowing down the aging process itself? We might get more value by delaying an onset of a cluster of conditions. And researchers have found clinical pathways to doing just this, to delaying the aging process. A good example of this is with resveratrol. Resveratrol was found to increase longevity in mice by about 30% and also improve their health. Resveratrol is a compound found in red wine. But before we all run out and uncork our favorite red, you should know that the amount of resveratrol used in the study was equal to 100 glasses a day. Maybe not a problem. The private sector has also recognized progress in this area of delaying aging. Just last year, a new company was formed, backed by Google and led by a former CEO of pharmaceutical giant Genentech. And the idea behind this company is R&D into unpacking the biological mechanisms of aging. So delayed aging may not be that far off. So we go back to our model and we can try to quantify its value, and we can compare the value of innovations that delay aging relative to innovations that treat individual diseases. So we look at four scenarios of innovation. Our first one under the baseline assumes that medical technology remains as it is today. A second one assumes that we have continued progress in cancer care, and the rate of progress is that of which we've seen over the last two decades. A third scenario looks at continued progress in heart disease, again, at the same rate we've witnessed over the last two decades. And then finally, we take our best scientific evidence emerging from biological studies, and we look at innovations that delay aging. What value do they bring? So let me turn to some results and some data. In 2010, there are 30 million healthy Americans age 65 and older. Under our baseline scenario, this will rise to 75.5 million in 2060. So what if we have innovations in cancer care and heart disease? Well, they bring value. We have about 500,000 to 1 million more healthy Americans in 2060. But let's compare that to delayed aging. Under our delayed aging scenario, innovations that delay aging, we have 10 million more healthy Americans in 2060 than we do under the other scenarios. So we can put a dollar value on those healthier, longer, better lives. And the social value with innovations that delay aging is substantial. It's $7 trillion. You're probably thinking that doesn't come at a cheap price tag, and you're right. The change in net entitlement costs associated with this innovation are about $3 trillion. But given the high price tag and the social value, the questions we should be asking are, do we want to pay for it? How do we pay for it? Are we investing enough in R&D? So a second example where innovation has a potential to make enormous impact and add a lot of value is in Alzheimer's disease. Alzheimer's disease is quickly becoming an urgent public health and fiscal concern. The size of the population with AD is going to increase dramatically over the next coming decades by over 153%. To give you an idea of some numbers, 2010, there were 3.5 million Americans with Alzheimer's disease. By 2050, there'll be 9.1 million. Alzheimer's disease is an incredibly expensive and devastating disease. The cost to society is great and will increase by 5 by 2050. And we're all paying for it, even if we're fortunate enough not to have someone in our family or a loved one with Alzheimer's disease. So as Artoga mentioned, there is no cure, there's no treatment. The treatment just treats symptoms right now. But what if medical innovation was able to, instead of treat symptoms, delay the onset of disease? What value would that bring? And clinical trials are already underway on drug therapies that alter the disease process itself. Actually, I think Artoga is on the way to solving this problem for us. One promising approach is indeed to combine brain imaging with drug therapy before symptoms appear. So what if we could delay the onset of Alzheimer's disease by 5 years? What value does that bring? So again, we go to our model and we estimate the value of delaying Alzheimer's disease. We start with a baseline model where innovation is the same, medical technology remains as it is today, and we compare that to innovation that delays the onset by 5 years. Again, looking at some data, what you see in the top yellow line is what I showed you, the number of million Americans in 2010 rising to 9 million. If we can delay the onset, there's a reduction of 41% in the number of Americans with Alzheimer's disease in 2050. That's a big number. So if we can delay Alzheimer's disease, a 70-year-old in 2010 who would have acquired Alzheimer's disease now lives 2.5 more years and spends fewer of those years with the disease. and only 60% of those people who would have acquired Alzheimer's disease now do so. So with this 5-year delay, society also saves $640 billion in healthcare costs. So if I go back to the beginning where we were with these incredible technologies that were talked about before I came up here, we can see that there's enormous value in innovations that are geared towards prevention. Our healthcare system, unfortunately, as a current state, does not sufficiently reward value. A first step is paying for health instead of health care, and to ensure that health policy keeps pace with the pace of innovation. Thank you.